Hey viewers, welcome. Peter here, University of Nairobi Faculty of Law, which used to be the School of Law. If you're here for the first time, please remember to subscribe. Then just sit back and enjoy watching. If you have been here before, thank you for your subscription.
Welcome to Public International Law. Lesson number 15 is about the concept of jus cogens. I say jus cogens simply because it is a derivative from Latin. However, the pronunciation by Black's Dictionary is jus cogens. It is a very important doctrine and principle in the international law. It is a newly emerging but nebulous concept in the international law as theory as well as practice. But what is jus cogens? How do we understand it in its application in the international legal system? Public international law, as I said in the previous conversations and discussions, is rich in principles, doctrines, rules that belong to the customary international law, and most of which have been elevated into the treaty law, which is the written law of the international legal system. So the part of the international legal system that is considered lex scripta is founded within the understanding of the treaties. The treaties serve as contracts or agreements at the international or at the global scale. But apart from this, our interest here is to understand the basic analysis and the elementary meaning of the word jus cogens, which of course international practitioners, in terms of international judges, international advocates and international professionals, international negotiators, as well as diplomats of high level, always make reference to this particular principle and doctrine, the rule of jus cogens. Let us get it in its historical basis. Let's get it right from its historical basis so that we understand the level of the analysis that come together with the jus cogens. Under section 10.1, the historical analysis of the concept of jus cogens is founded within the understanding of the Roman jurists. Of course, the Romans were very skillful when it comes to the legal practice. And that is the reason for which we keep on maintaining and making references to Latin words and terminologies in the sense of law, but also in the practice of law. First and foremost, under section 10.2.1, we look at jus dispositivum. This is also a Latin terminology that expresses the understanding of norms that are generated through certain agreements among the citizens of Rome. The Roman Empire, of course, had got jus civilis, which was the body of law, the body of court that was regulating the lives of the citizens of the Roman Empire. However, the non-citizens, including the slaves, had also another set of rules that was governing their life, but also the jus ad gentes or jus gentium that deals with the relationship between different nations, which of course translates into what we today refer to as the public international law. But besides all this, the Romans were so clear on one thing, that the law as coded does not cover everything about the norms that people always create in different agreements, which may be customary. But such agreements that people do engage into are the so-called jus dispositivum. However, the Romans came up with substantive and preemptory norms, a set of norms of which one cannot go around in order to disobey them or to change them or to modify them. These are the jus cogens. At the national level, in our domestic legal practice and legal system, where can we collocate jus dispositivum and jus cogens? Let us look at it this way. Parliament can make any law, provided that it is done procedurally and within the legislative rules that make that particular law valid and legitimate, but also authoritative. However, still, can Parliament come up, for instance, with a bill of Parliament that rules on committing genocide or committing war atrocity, or maybe committing crimes against humanity of any type or any kind? This is where we find the core principle and the core sense of what is jus cogens. That means it is a preemptory norm within the principles and values that in Kenya are found within Article 10 on the national values and principles of governance. This read together with the Bill of Rights and other areas and parts of the Constitution that are considered basic structure in the doctrine of the basic structure of the Constitution. Parliament cannot make any law in violation of such principles and values. This is what we are looking at. That is from the domestic or municipal understanding of the concept of jus cogens. How about the international law? How about the understanding of jus cogens in the international law? This one brings us to another point. Looking at jus cogens against the obligations of the state, and such international obligations of the state are considered under the rights of erga omnes, as well as the duty and obligations of jus cogens. In this case, erga omnes, as understood within the international jurisprudence, is that the international organizations, treaties that the states enter into, whether trade treaties or treaties to carry out a certain activity that is jointly signed into and ratified into law by the very signatories, which in this case are the sovereigns, are supposed to enjoy erga omnes right. That means their applicability across the board. For instance, what the United Nations arrives at as the resolution or as a convention or agreement shall be considered binding even upon those quote-unquote nations that have not yet become the jury members of the entire organization under the United Nations Charter. In this case, it is applicable erga omnes, or beyond the coverage of the treaty. That means you are part, or you are privy of the treaty, or you have ratified the treaty or not. That type of norm within the treaty is considered to be applicable even to you in this regard. In that case, it is justifying the very principles of jus cogens. Jus cogens in the international law is emerging, especially after the Second World War, because of the reality of atrocities that are considered very troublesome when it comes to our human conscience. Such activities as committing genocide of any kind, whether it is based on religion or it is based on ethnicity or racism or of any kind, is under the principle of jus cogens. That means no state as individual can come up with a law that would legalize or would make it lawful the committing of genocide on the people, or committing those crimes, quote unquote, international crimes. You can find them in the Rome Statute and also the practice of the International Criminal Court, and also within the very principles of which we are talking. Another element that I would like to relate with the understanding of jus cogens is in the principle of pacta sunt servanda. This is another Latin terminology that is the oldest principle within the customary international law, which of course has defined the law of treaty, the Vienna Convention of 1969. As we can again look at pacta sunt servanda, which is a Latin concept, simply means that pacta is an agreement. Sunt is the verb part of it. Servanda is observation. That means the agreement, once entered into, must be observed by the parties that are privy of the contract or of the agreement. That is what we find in the law of treaty, which we shall see and discuss in the later stages. In this stage, it is very significant to look at jus cogens within the understanding of pacta sunt servanda, which means any pact, any agreement, or any legal arrangement, or negotio juridico in Latin, legal transaction, that people always get into, or states, or in legal personalities, or whether we are talking about the incorporations, must not go against these preemptory norms of jus cogens. And if they do, they shall be considered void ex jure. That is, they are considered null and void ab initio. This is a principle that really restrains and constrains all treaties, all agreements and arrangements the states can get into in conducting or transacting their businesses in their own interests. And this one should not be seen to be going around the jus cogens. So jus cogens are preemptory norms. They are overriding norms. They are norms that should not be interfered with or should not be rendered illegal or rendered invalid by any law in disregard of the sovereignty of the state and the power of the state to make its own laws and enforce those laws through the interpretation of the courts of those countries. So between the municipal and the international law, we still uphold the concept of jus cogens, which of course we will find in our study and our training to become smart and capable lawyers and legal persons with the capacity to handle international disputes and controversies, and also to handle the international diplomatic negotiations that yield into treaties and yield into certain resolutions of the United Nations General Assembly and the United Nations Security Council. And with this, we find that the use of jus cogens is binding, and it is a preemptory norm both at the two levels, the international level as well as the municipal level. Thank you for watching this, and thank you for being here. I still encourage you to subscribe and follow this video because they help us to understand what would be perhaps very complicated